Hi, it's Jessica DaMassa with WTF Health. I'm here at the HISA studio at HIC 2019, and joining me right now, I have Angela Ryan. She is the Chief Clinical Information Officer for the Australian Digital Health Agency and also the President of the Australasian College of Health Informatics.
Well done.
Wow, is that a mouthful? Oh my goodness. And so in short, she was introduced to me as like the most important person in digital health in Australia. So I think we should just go with that.
Thanks for the little shape up.
Yeah, right there. Yeah. All right, so as the most important person in digital health in Australia, we need to pick your brain about how the digital transformation of healthcare is going here. So how's it going? You guys are a few years off of opt out with the My Health record.
A few months, even.
A few months, really.
Yes,
oh, okay.
A few months. So
I remember it was passed a few years ago, but the actual implementation started a few months ago.
Correct.
Okay, great.
Correct.
So how's it going?
So it's going pretty well.
Okay.
So look, we recognize we've got still a lot more work to do. But in the last 6 months or so opt-out concluded at the end of January,
okay.
Just this year, and all of the records were created at the end of February. We now have more than 90% of the population who have a My Health record.
Wow, okay.
And we have an incredibly, a much larger volume of clinical information now in the record as well. So it's an entirely different value proposition from where it was even 12 months ago.
Okay, talk more about that. So what's in there? What's
so
in that
what's
record?
In there?
Yeah,
okay.
Tell me what's in there.
Where do I start? So you may be aware GPs have been contributing probably for the longest with shared health summaries.
Okay.
But then in addition to that, we have most of the public and private hospitals contributing discharge summaries across the country.
Okay.
We have community pharmacies who've really bought into the proposition and uploading dispense records. So while we have had prescription information, we've now also got dispense information from community pharmacies. We've also got ever-increasing volumes of pathology and diagnostic imaging report information. And in addition to that, there are advanced care directives that can be uploaded by patients. And patients can also upload their own information.
Oh, like from a tracker or...?
Not quite yet.
Okay.
So that's actually manually entered, but you know that's a bit of a work in progress. So there is sort of, I guess, where we may have been even 2 years ago to where we are now, it's entirely different. So we're just, you know, obviously recognizing there's still a lot more work to be done, and we're working closely now with clinicians, particularly hospital clinicians, to sort of, you know, I guess, talk to them in more detail about the value of it to sort of, you know, help increase their awareness and use so that, you know, the benefits really start to flow.
That's exciting.
And
so,
really,
I mean, as
exciting.
Far as the clinicians and their reaction to this, I mean, what has it been so far? I mean, it's obviously very new in its early days, but what's the reaction been as this has rolled out and especially netting the number that, you know, only 10% have decided to opt out?
Yes, look, I think, it was sort of, we've worked really closely with the broader community. So obviously we had a message that we needed to communicate to the entire population. So in many respects, it was, important that the message was that people understood that they had that choice.
Mm-hmm.
It's different, obviously, for clinicians because they don't have to opt in. They opt in. They choose whether or not they want to participate.
Okay.
Whereas now for patients, you know, have that choice of opt out.
Okay.
So, it's been a bit of a journey, so there are sort of, I guess, some concerns still that clinicians express. There's more that we could do with the way the system looks and feels, and I think we have our Chief Digital Officer, Steve Isser, who's doing a lot of work in that space to sort of drive strategy around, well, what's next? What is it?
Sure.
What is the... Because at the moment, there are a lot of documents in there, so it's not necessarily as user-friendly as it could be, although, you know, again... there's a lot of rich information there that, you know, people would otherwise not have access to. So from that perspective, it's wonderful. But yes, we recognise and we're doing a lot of work around the usability of the system, mm-hmm. and with the other systems that connect so that it becomes better supported in inside workflows. So there's better integration.
Now, are you
workflows.
Guys are you able to draw any analysis from the data at this point yet? I mean, this is so early, and this is such a monumental undertaking. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know where you're at with it. So, are you able to yet discern some of the nuances that the data is showing? Are you able to look at any type of reporting yet, or is that still to come?
So, in terms of the reporting, and the way we are starting to look at the information that's coming in. We don't have access to everything, but we have access to a number of different metrics that tell us about changes in clinician behaviour, so what clinicians are starting to do more of, what sorts of documents that they're looking at in certain contexts, what will be a rich source of information in a particular sort of scenario. So we're starting to see trends upward in terms of usage. So we're starting to see views climb, and the view is the way for us to tell if people are actually looking at the record. So you can be connected, but if you're not viewing, then obviously that means it isn't really being used. So we're starting to see the views go up.
Good.
And certainly where I've been working on a particular program with emergency department clinicians, and so we go to emergency departments in metropolitan as well as regional and some of the more remote areas, and we're talking to ED clinicians, and we notice that there is starting to be an uplift after those contacts, so that's kind of exciting. So I think we're kind of at the we're still kind of back at the beginning, we're certainly starting to see that change. So, I mean, watch this space. There'll be more information coming in the next 6 to 12 months.
Fantastic. I want to know, too, from your perspective, as you're looking at the rest of the digital health ecosystem, this obviously is so focused on medical record, but what else is exciting here? I would be remiss if I didn't ask for all of the startups, back in the States and in the rest of the world in Europe, who watch my show, about what the Australian government is into as far as digital health is concerned.
So, look, as it turns out, quite a bit. So we have a national digital health strategy. It was actually published 2 years ago, but it's got 7 strategic priorities. My health record was the first one, because the very first priority that pretty much everyone signed up to was having health information whenever and wherever it's needed. But my health record is not the only thing that the agency does, and we've actually been working away on a whole range of other areas over the last few years.
Very good. Give us an example. Okay, something cool that you're excited about?
Interoperability.
Okay.
So obviously that's the sort of the holy grail.
Yeah.
I've been in digital health a long time, and for me that would actually be some kind of
accomplishment.
It would be huge. And I think my health record exists because we don't yet have a whole connected health system, and obviously we have a fairly complex environment into which health functions. But so over the next few months, and there's been a lengthy consultation occurring, there will be a roadmap around what interoperability needs to be and what we need to do to sort of get there. So that's going to be very exciting. That will be
Definitely.
Published later in the year. But the other thing I'm very excited about is the health workforce.
Okay.
So one of the priorities is around workforce and education. So really growing capabilities of frontline clinicians, GPs, anyone that represents a member of the workforce in health.
Okay.
So we've got clinicians patients and clinicians at the centre, but then there's a whole lot of other roles.
Oh, absolutely.
That also are influenced or impacted by digital health. So I'm lucky enough to be leading a piece of work in concert with clinical professor Meredith Makem, who's the chief medical advisor for the agency. And we have been running a consultation across the sector, so with universities, with vocational ed, with clinician and consumer peaks, with different parts right across the spectrum, to look at, what do people need from digital health? So how can digital health better enable the workforce? But also, what does the workforce itself need to be able to sort of be better equipped to use the tools? So that's another roadmap. So that's the second roadmap.
Has anything that you found out so far surprised you in that regard?
Look, I think what has surprised me is that there's some great exemplars already. So, I knew that they were there, but we've been exposed to them. So we're hoping to make them more visible. So great programs of work where people are actually doing and working closely with the health workforce to sort of shift the needle there and, help people feel better equipped. But what else? I wonder if anything else has surprised me. I think people are... The other thing that I'll also note is that everyone is really excited about it. Everyone is really invested and recognise what a huge problem it is. And we in the agency have one of our strategic priorities is around innovation. and sort of working internationally, and we have a global digital health partnership. So that is, I think, around 30 countries who we're participating with currently. United States is one, obviously, through the Office of the National Coordinator.
For Health IT, yep.
Yep.
I know those guys.
Yes, I bet you do. And Don Rucker is the chair of our interoperability work stream.
Yep.
So we recognise that this is a problem everywhere. So a lot of the, and that's another point I'd make, is that, like, there's lots of cool things around and lots of great things that technology can do for us, but we're kind of still wrestling with some of those really big, wicked problems, like interoperability, like secure messaging, like making sure the health workforce is better equipped. And I think in having this global collaboration, we're sort of sharing learnings, we're writing white papers together, we're coming together for summits, and we're sort of learning from each other, because we recognise, you know, we don't all need to keep trying to solve the same problem over and over again. So it's sort of a, that, you know, that's also been really wonderful. So the government's been very supportive of that. We work closely, of course, with our government partners in that activity, but it's been really exciting.
To weigh in for me, last question for you on the startup ecosystem, and I only mention this because I know the Office of the National Coordinator for Health IT in the U.S. and Don Rucker and his team, they've really gone, you know, I think above and beyond in a lot of ways to reach out to the startup communities, the little health tech companies, the digital health companies that are developing things, and kind of opening up a pathway in for them to work with the government, have access to de-identified data, or have, you know, been kind of pushing
amazing.
Around different kinds of regulations that loop the little guys in. So it's not just the health incumbents. What's the Australian government doing in that regard? Do you have the startup ecosystem here? I mean, I know it's smaller than in the US. I know they are here, though, but are you guys working with that startup community in any way?
So I think that is an interesting question. We work closely with industry partners. We don't fund sort of startups as such.
Yeah.
It is a different sort of premise than it is in the US. And in fact, I was lucky enough back last year, I was traveling in the US on a Churchill Fellowship, and I went and spent some time at TMC in Houston, which is obviously a, you know, big startup space.
Yeah.
So that was really exciting and really great to see what people were
doing,
what they're doing and what's possible. And in fact, our Austrade partners, so government, working closely with startups here, sort of facilitating relationships overseas. So I think there's some really great stuff going on. There's also another organisation called And Health, who are doing really great things.
I've seen them around. I've run into them.
Under Bronwyn LeGrice's stewardship. So it's quite a vibrant ecosystem, but of course there's, you know, probably always more that could be done in that space. But
exciting,
you know,
though.
It is. It's very exciting times. It's we feel like it's, you know, it's, well, it's so ubiquitous now, digital health, that, you know, we've just got to get on with it, really.
I love it. Just got to get on with it, really. Those are parting words from you. I love it. Just got to get on with it, really. Angela, thank you so much for joining us.
Right.
I love it.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm Jessica DaMassa with WTF Health. Thanks so much for watching.